Hi, in a recent video I encountered a fascinating problem. I built a logic circuit that works as a logic AND function when receiving inputs of 5 volts or 0 volts. Then I built a push button that generated 5 volts or 0 volts at its output. Individually, both were like a charm, but when I connected them together, they didn't. This led me to delve deeper into the circuit's behavior, but that ultimately pointed me to the concept of impedance, which describes a more general problem I'd like to explore and understand. I write code for a living, and in computer programming, when you feed the output of function A as an argument of function B, whatever B does cannot affect A. So when working with electronics, I came with that mindset, which was wrong. In digital electronics, what I said would be the expected behavior, but getting my circuit to behave like that requires me to follow and understand some rules. I will need to learn those rules to connect components to each other, which has become a theme in a few of my videos. This video is a departure from my usual content. Instead of focusing on a practical build, I'll be delving into some theory behind it. I'll discuss a simplifying notion of impedance and its crucial role when connecting circuits. This understanding will shed light on why input and output voltages are just part of the puzzle when interfacing two digital components. It will also help us comprehend the use of pull-ups or pull-down resistors in digital circuits and when they may or may not work. Let me briefly recap the circuit we built before. We have this push button, which when pressed, connects through a wire to 5 volts. And when released, the output is connected to ground through this resistor. We also have this pseudo logic gate that emits a voltage of around 0.8 volts when one of the inputs is attached to 0 volts. But when I connected this input, which is connected to 0 volts, to the button output, which also is 0 volts, then I got a very different output of more than 4 volts. My conclusion is that this wire with 0 volts and this button output with 0 volts cannot be equivalent. In other words, the voltage is not the only important property of this interconnection. That was a surprise to me. Voltage is significant because we use it to encode the ones and zeros or highs and lows of our digital signal. However, it's not the sole determinant of our circuit's behavior. There are other physical characteristics at play, and being aware of them is vital. They can influence our signals, as we've just seen in this demonstration. This was a fascinating revelation to me. What these zero-volt lines have is a different impedance. The general concept of impedance is a complex topic in alternating current circuits, which I don't know enough to explain well. But I can give you a simplified model that works okay in digital circuits where signals aren't changing, like here. And this simplified model abuses the term impedance a bit, but it's easy to understand and still useful. If it detects a problem, it will also be a problem on other occasions. It still may miss impedance issues in more complex scenarios. If you're more experienced and think this mental model can cause problems, even knowing it's a simplification, let me know in the comments. When we analyzed the problem in the previous circuit, we discussed that this path through resistors forms a voltage divider, with different voltage drops across each resistor proportional to the resistance. The analysis is specific to this particular circuit and can only be done once we combine the input and the output. But let me show you a different way of looking at it that can help. Let's consider this particular spot where the input meets the output. This input has a path connecting to 5 volts through a resistor. And this output has a path connecting to ground, also through a resistor, to the same point. So the point is connected to both 5 volts and 0 volts. And it cannot have both voltages simultaneously. A point at the circuit needs to measure some voltage. So which one is it? Well, the paths have resistances. And we can say that this resistor connecting to 5 volts will pull the voltage towards 5 volts, and this other resistor is pulling towards 0 volts. You could see this as a tug of war for the voltage at this point. And in this tug of war, the strength of the pull is inverse to the resistor value. The voltage will go towards the stronger side, and the bigger the strength difference, the closer the result will be to that value. In this case, this low resistance resistor on the 5 volt side pulls harder, so the voltage is much closer to 5 volts. This may appear like the same analysis as before in different words, but now we can use this approach to look separately at the input and output circuits and understand how each will generally work when connected with other outputs and inputs. Now I don't have to worry about how each component is built. I only need to know how much each one is pulling towards a voltage. Let's look again at this push button, our output circuit. Currently, its output is low, 0 volts. Any output circuit outputting low does so by creating a path between the output and the ground line. We will say that the output impedance of the circuit will be the resistance in that path. In this case, the output is 0 volts, but it's not being pulled very strongly to 0 volts. It has an output impedance of 1000 ohms. Repeating something I said before, this analysis can be done while the circuit is not changing. If I push the button, the output doesn't just change its value from low to high. In this case, it also changes the impedance. If the output is high, the circuit has created a path from 5 volts to the output. But this path may have a different resistance than before. There's no resistor here. We have a plain wire that can be analyzed as a 0-ohm resistor. In other words, the output impedance now is 0 ohms. This lets us examine this output circuit with new eyes. We don't characterize its output as a voltage, but as a pair of values, the voltage and the output impedance. We can compare that to a different output circuit I've used in other videos, this single point double throw slider switch. There are no resistors in this case, so the output impedance is very low for both high and low signals. That explains why this circuit has fewer issues interfacing with others than the push button. I can do the same with the input of this AND function circuit. I don't know the value of the input for this one, so I'll analyze both possibilities. If the input is low, this point is connected to 5 volts through a resistor and a diode. And the diode is forward biased, so it should have negligible resistance. So I'll ignore it and say that the input impedance is 220 ohms. If the input is high, then this diode is reverse biased, and a reverse biased diode is usually considered an open circuit. An open circuit can be treated as infinity ohms, especially in this case where voltage is the same on both sides. After analyzing the output, we can prepare a table similar to the one we use for the input. But the fun happens when we put both tables together. The point that connects the input with the output is now being pulled by two circuits. Both influence that point because that's the physical reality of electricity. The junction doesn't know whether it's an input or an output. The notions of input and output are concepts that we humans try to impose on this physical object to make it valuable for us. To align this physical reality with our expectations, we would like the output circuit to have a very big say on what the voltage is, and the input to have very little. That means that we want low impedance outputs and high impedance inputs. If you look at this table row, that condition fails, and that's why these two circuits didn't work together. If you saw my other video, you may remember that I patched a solution by reversing the button logic and tied it to 5 volts with the pull-up and to the ground with the wire. That effectively reversed impedances, fixing the compatibility problems. You can see that now the output impedance is much lower than the input impedance for every single row. The big takeaway is, make your outputs low impedance and your inputs high impedance. This is a rule in digital circuits, where you want your signals to be accurate. You may find other materials discussing impedance for different purposes, like connecting power circuits to motors. Those may tell you about this notion of impedance matching, because there are rules optimizing power transfer rather than signal accuracy. And in those scenarios, you want both impedances to be low or both to be high. But that's a very different situation than mine. I don't want to transfer power. I want to move bits between logic circuits. So the rule you see on screen still applies as long as you're doing digital logic. And what exactly are low and high impedances? Well, there's no exact number, but my very rough rule of thumb for digital circuits is that low will be less than 100 ohms and high more than 1000 ohms. But the most important thing is that you look at the ratio between outputs and inputs, and you should have at least a 10 to 1 ratio as a very poor baseline. In a 5-volt circuit, your outputs could be shifting the voltage at most 10%, which is half a volt. That's a barely tolerable minimum. Ideally, you want much more. I've discussed an extremely simplified model for impedance, but it can be made even more accessible. Instead of creating a table with all possible cases and aligning them, note the worst case for the input and the worst for the output. Given that we want low on-bit impedance, the worst cases are the big numbers when looking at outputs. For inputs, it is the opposite. The worst case is the smallest number. So we could say that our push button has an output impedance of 1000 ohms, and our logic circuit has an input impedance of 220 ohms. So they will not work together. This extra simplification could be overcautious. For example, it will notice that my pull-up button version actually works. But again, it's not a poor simplification. It's probably a good idea not to rely too much on those edge cases. The concept of impedance may help you understand my future videos, because it will let me explore some problems in circuits that I was overlooking before. Going back to my AND with diode circuits, this time, looking at its output beside its inputs, you can see that it has both an input and output impedance of 220 ohms controlled by this single resistor. And that's a severe drawback in the design. If I try to improve the output impedance, that is, make it lower, I will make the input impedance worse, and the other way around. This is a crucial design problem that this conceptual tool makes glaringly visible, and it's a problem that took me much work to analyze in the previous video. If we look at the transistor-based gates that I've built so far, now we can see an essential reason for having these 10k resistors on each input. It doesn't just save power, but also increases the input impedance, which is a good thing. I hope this can help you understand and debug interfacing issues in your circuits. I will probably be referring back to this in future videos. I'll see you in those.